Well, thank you. As Chris said, I'm a bit hoarse, so I'm just hoping my voice will hold out. I may have to shorten the lecture if it doesn't, or it may become inaudible. I'm talking about the extended mind, which is really the idea of the mind extending beyond the brain. It's a remarkable thing in the 21st century that one of the things we know least about scientifically is our own minds. Within the philosophy of mind, the very existence of consciousness is called the hard problem. I'm not going to be talking about the philosophy of mind this evening, but with a more limited question, it's still a big one, of where our minds are. Now, for some of you who've been brought up in the materialist way of thinking, it seems a silly question to ask, because the obvious answer is in the brain. And that's what most people in the modern world have as their default assumption. It follows from the philosophy of materialism or physicalism that says matter's the only reality, therefore mind is a product of matter or material activity. Your mind is what your brain does. The other traditional theory of the mind is a dualistic theory, the brain's material and the mind's non-material. This is sometimes called Cartesian dualism. The mind's not in space and time, it's not made of matter, it's and really, in many ways, outside the scope of science. Well, obviously, that theory is not very helpful for science, and it's not taken seriously by most scientists, although most ordinary people take it for granted, at least implicitly. What I'm suggesting is a third way of looking at things, which is that the mind is inside the brain and extends beyond it through fields. Now, the exact nature of these fields I may not have time to discuss this evening, but the basic idea is the mind is not just confined to the brain, but it is part of a physical extended system. It's not immaterial and outside space and time, it's in space and time, but it's not confined to the brain. We're very familiar with the idea of fields from magnetic fields, first described or called fields by Faraday here in London in the 1840s. And a magnetic field is in the magnet and it stretches out invisibly beyond the magnet. It can have effects at a distance because the field is not limited to the magnet itself. Now the same is true of the Earth's gravitational field. It's inside the Earth and it stretches out invisibly far beyond the Earth. That's why we're all on the floor, we're not floating around here, because of the Earth's gravitational field. It stretches out invisibly as far as the Moon and keeps the Moon in orbit and stretches yet further than that. So we don't have any problem with the idea of an invisible field that's inside and beyond a material body. That was the basis of Newton's theory, which was one of the foundational theories of science. We're also familiar with invisible fields from mobile phones. Your mobile phone has an invisible field stretching around it, an electromagnetic field, a field within it, electromagnetic field within it and around it. What I'm suggesting is that our minds are like that. They have fields of activity that stretch out way beyond our brains. They're rooted in the brains, but they stretch out beyond them. Now, this may seem to some people a strange, eccentric idea. It's actually very mainstream at the moment within people discussing the nature of consciousness to consider this idea. It started as a rather way-out idea. One of the people who got this debate going was Professor Max Velmans, who was a professor of psychology here at Goldsmiths. And in his theory of the reflexive mind, he points out the conventional theory is that if you look at a cat, then somehow your brain produces an image of a cat inside the brain. You think this image of the cat, but it's all inside the brain. The cat seems to be out there, but the image is in the brain. On the right-hand side is his interpretation. The brain responds to the visual stimuli that come through the optic nerve from the cat. But then you produce an image of the cat, but that image is in the mind, but it's not inside the brain. it's where the cat is. So that's Velleman's theory. And this is now widely discussed by a range of philosophers and people in consciousness studies. One of them is Alva Noe, who wrote a recent book called Out of Our Heads, which is emphasizing that we stretch far beyond our heads. This is what he says. We are out of our heads. We are in the world and out of it. We are patterns of active engagement with fluid boundaries and changing components. We are distributed. There's another group of philosophers and consciousness studies people who are talking about this kind of model under the name radical externalism. So this is very much a debate in thinking about consciousness at the moment. And I want us to think about that this evening, and the easiest way to think about it is through vision. When you see me standing here now, you're seeing a three-dimensional, full-color image of me. And the question I'm asking is, where is that image located? If your mind is inside your brain, then your image of me is somewhere inside your brain. Everything you're seeing exists inside your brain as a kind of virtual reality display in three dimensions and full color, mysteriously present inside the nervous tissue, generated by it and present within it. That's the official view. Everything is inside your brain. If you look at the sky you're seeing is inside your brain. One of the debating points on this was a paper put forward by a philosopher of mind, which was called, Is Your Skull Beyond the Sky? And being a materialist, he said, yes. The sky that you're seeing when you look at the sky is inside your head. Your skull is beyond everything you're experiencing. Everything you're experiencing is inside your head. That, as I say, is the official view that's taken for granted in most academic institutions and in most neuroscience. The funny thing is, it hasn't got a shred of evidence for it. Nobody's ever seen this three-dimensional virtual reality display inside a head. And if you do operations on people who are conscious during the operation and look at the grey matter, nobody sees flickering three-dimensional images going on inside the head. It's an entirely theory-based idea. The mind must be the brain, because if I'm a materialist, that's what I believe. It has nothing to do with experience or evidence. What I'm suggesting is an alternative theory, which is similar to the ones I've just considered, which is that your image of me is not located inside your head, it's located right here. It's in your mind, but it's not inside your brain. The vision involves a two-way process. Light comes in, changes happen in the eyes and in the brain, and then images are projected out to where you see them. So when I look at you, my image of you is projected to where you are and coincides with where you actually are. Sometimes I may have hallucinations or illusions, in which case I project out images which don't coincide with where you are, in which case it'd be rather difficult to lead a normal life. The reason we got here this evening is because our images do coincide with where things are most of the time. So vision in this analysis involves a two-way process. And this is not an original theory of vision. It's the traditional one found in all cultures everywhere in the world. Everyone takes for granted, except in educated Western circles, that vision involves this outward projection. Traditional peoples, the ancient Greeks thought this. Plato thought it, for example, and so did Euclid, the great geometer. Euclid was the first person to work out clearly why mirrors work. Euclid's theory of mirrors, which is still in every physics textbook for GCSE, you'll all have seen this. It's basically Euclid's theory, unreconstructed, slightly rephrased in words. Euclid's theory is the light is bent by the mirror. It goes into your eyes. Your eyes produce these virtual images and project them out. But being virtual images projected by the mind, they go straight through the glass, and so you see them behind the glass. That's why you have virtual images behind the mirror. Every time you look in a mirror, you're seeing your visual projections. You're not You know, because your projections are not bent by the glass, but the light is. Well, this theory is, as I say, part of almost every culture. And Jean Piaget, the developmental psychologist, showed that in the West, children until the age of about 10 or 11 also take it for granted that vision involves an outward projection of images. That's why Superman comics often show rays coming out of Superman's eyes. And Roald Dahl's story Matilda is very popular with children because she has eye beams that she can move things with. For most children, that makes total sense. But Piaget found that by the age of 10 or 11, he said the average child learns the correct view, which is that thoughts and images are invisible things located inside the head. So most of us have learned the correct view when we were quite young, far too young to challenge it or question it or treat it skeptically. We just absorbed this theory as if it's true because all the grown-ups seem to think it's true. But as I say, I don't think it is true, and it has very little evidence in its favour. Now, you may think this is just a kind of philosophical discussion. It doesn't really make any difference. But it is, in fact, testable scientifically. And because I'm an empirical scientist, the part that interests me is how do you test it? When I first started thinking about this, I thought, well, if my mind reaches out to touch what I'm looking at through a field, or if you don't want to call it a field, just call it an influence or an extension of the mind. If I look at somebody and they don't know I'm looking at them, could they feel my looks? And as soon as I asked that question, I realized, well, yes, I've had this experience myself. I've found myself turning around and somebody's looking at me. I've also found when I look at somebody else, sometimes the person turns around and looks straight at me. Surveys have shown that more than 90% of the population, grown-ups and children, have had this experience. It's extremely common. I bet most people in this room have experienced it one way or the other, or probably both ways round during the course of their lives. Some people have it quite frequently. So what does psychology have to tell us about this? Well, for the whole length of official psychology since the 19th century, the standard way of explaining it has been to say, well, it's just an illusion. You turn around for reasons you feel uncomfortable or for whatever reason, and sometimes someone's staring at you and you just imagine that they've made you turn around, but you just forget the millions of times you're wrong. Or else, when you look at somebody and they turn around, well, you look at people all the time, it's only occasionally they turn around and you think that's significant, but it's not really, it's just a coincidence. So that's the standard way of dealing with it. It's an armchair argument that for 100 years was pretty well evidence-free. It's only really since the 1980s that there's been a serious empirical investigation of this. There were two papers, one at the end of the 19th century, one at the beginning of the 20th, which were written by skeptics saying this can't possibly happen and doesn't seem to happen. One of them was by a professor who called up students from the front of the class and said, you stand there and you tell me when I'm looking at you. And they were sort of embarrassed, flushed, on the spot. And they didn't come out much better than chance in one or two tests. It's kind of anecdotal evidence. But you can do proper experiments on this. They're quite simple and cheap. They're so cheap and simple that a child can do them. And now many thousands of children already have done them. They've been widely done in schools in Britain, Germany, and the United States, as well as in universities and colleges. The most basic test is where the subject is blindfolded with an airline-style blindfold to prevent peripheral vision, and somebody sits behind them, and in a randomized series of trials, either looks or doesn't look, with a signal for the beginning of the trial from a click or a beep. So you hear the click or beep, and you have to guess, looking or not looking, are you being looked at or not? Now, it's a very artificial test, but in this test, well, there's been a great many trials of this kind now. This is a summary of some of these simple experiments. 30,000 trials. The percentage of correct guesses was above the chance level of 50%, not very much above it, 54.7%. But with such a huge number, it's massively significant statistically, far more significant than the existence of the Higgs boson. And these are fairly simple, straightforward experiments. They've been done also by people looking through windows and through one-way mirrors. And one of these experiments has been running in the Amsterdam Science Museum for 15 years, one of the biggest experiments ever conducted. Tens of thousands of trials. And the results there are massively above chance. What they show, and what my own data shows, that the most sensitive subjects are children under the age of about 10. That's one of the reasons I did some of my experiments in primary schools. I think most of us get a bit more thick-skinned. We're used to being in crowded places. This research has shown consistent effects. This happened. There's a paper in which I review all the evidence, the references there in the Journal of Consciousness Studies. So if you want to see the overview of these and all the data and the references and so on, it's all there if you want it. My own papers are all on my own website, available free, and you can easily just click on them in the sense of being stared at section. This research was taken up by some skeptics at Middlesex University who did experiments with students, and they tested them over and over again, and they again came up with a positive result, similar to my own. But they thought it must be due to a statistical anomaly, so they tried to explain it in terms of arguing about the randomized sequence that was used in the experiments. Their theory predicted you should see a particular pattern of results. They didn't actually analyze their data to see if they fitted the hypothesis. They just assumed they must be right. I asked for the data to analyze it to see if it fitted their hypothesis, and they said no, they wouldn't give it to me because they planned to do the analysis themselves at some stage in the future. Well, I'm still waiting. They then did the experiment again, where one of the skeptics became the looker himself instead of having students do the looking. Then he got the results he expected, not significant. But the vast majority of research on this subject has shown positive results, even when done by skeptics. In the Skeptical Inquirer, there was a paper by an American professor of psychology called Robert Baker, who did experiments by sitting in the University of Kentucky library, looking at the back of students' necks to see how many of them would turn round. And he found out of 45 students, 5 actually turned round when he was looking at them. But instead of saying there might be something in this, he said that 2 of them, the results had to be discounted because they were restless while he was looking at them, so it might just be restlessness. Of course, they might have been restless because he was looking at them. And the other 3, he said they exhibited paranoid tendencies, and therefore these data could be discounted. So, not a very impressive paper. So, we're here at an area where most people think this happens. The great majority of the experimental evidence suggests it's real. Even tests by some skeptics have given positive results. And if you talk to any of your friends about it, you'll find that most people just take it for granted, of course. And here's an area where a vast amount of everyday experience, a great body of experimental evidence, suggests something's going on that ought not to be happening if your mind's just located inside your head. But as I've said, a large number of materialist philosophers are now saying the mind must be bigger, more than the brain, radical externalism. These people are not dualists or spiritually favorable people or anything. This is just simply an ongoing debate in philosophy of mind. And there's nothing to be lost, in my opinion, even if you're a materialist, by thinking the mind might have a field-like aspect. So much else in nature does. Why not minds, especially when we know so little about them? Now, this research has also been done through closed-circuit television. The first experiments were done in the United States where people had skin resistance measurements, galvanic skin response measurements, to measure their emotional arousal. And they were looked at through closed-circuit television by somebody in another room, so they couldn't possibly hear or smell or feel anything through the senses of what the other person was doing. Their physiology changed significantly when they were being looked at compared with when they weren't being looked at. These results were then taken up by a skeptic here in Britain, Richard Wiseman. And in his first experiments, where students did the looking, he got significant results, positive results. He then decided they must be due to a statistical anomaly, something to do with the way the statistical sequence of trials had been carried out, and something to do with the way in which people's skin response might have changed over time during the course of the experiment. He made definite predictions. He didn't test it from his own data. When I asked for his data, he told me it had been lost. But he then later recovered half of it. And the half he recovered, which I'm very glad he did, didn't show what he'd predicted. He then changed the method and he did the staring himself. And then he got non-significant results. Marilyn Schlitz, worked at the Institute of Noetic Sciences, who had positive results, then did an experiment with Wiseman in his labs at the University of Hertfordshire. She got positive results, he didn't. Now that's interesting, you see, because he could get non-significant results by not looking very hard, which in a subsequent interview with Caroline Watt, he said, I was so bored by this, it seemed so pointless. Whereas Marilyn Schlitz thought it could work and was looking very hard, focusing on the people, and she got positive results. So it's not a symmetrical thing. It's easy to see how someone could not get positive results by not wanting to, but she couldn't have got positive results just by wanting to, because there was no sensory transfer of information. So this is an area, again, where there have been several other projects by skeptics. Susan Blackmore had a student do a project on this to see whether people who had a tendency towards schizophrenia were more sensitive, and she and her student got a significant positive response. And Chris here, who he and I've been in debate about this kind of thing for a very long time, we're old sparring partners, and one of the things I so like about Chris is that he actually does do experiments. A lot of skeptics sit in their armchairs and try and dismiss evidence that doesn't fit their worldview. But Chris actually does experiments, and he took up an experiment with a student on this, and they got a result that showed an effect. He and I then had a debate about it. It was significant on a t-test, in a one-tailed test, but it wasn't significant in a two-tailed test. So here we've got an effect that's marginally, it depends on the test you use. Chris is right that the one-tailed test was the more appropriate one. No, the two-tailed test was the more appropriate one. And it was just non-significant, this result. But we're talking here about a body of research, all of which I review in my review article in the Journal of Consciousness Studies, which, for the most part, has given very significant positive results. And even much of the research by card-carrying skeptics has given positive or ambiguous results. So there's no particular reason why anyone needs to feel this phenomenon can't possibly exist, it's nonsense. I think it does exist. I don't think it's nonsense. The reason so many people say they've experienced it is, I think, because it's actually happening. There may be occasions when they turn around and it's just a coincidence and there's selective memory and so on. That may well be going on. But I think it's a real phenomenon that's really happening. And it's rather surprising to me that it happens through closed-circuit television, because it shows that it's not just the extension of the mind to something that's in direct vision, but even seeing an image could have an effect. I did some experiments to see whether it worked with photographs. And even with photographs, with people who knew each other well, they seemed to be able to tell when people were looking at their photo. I now have a new version of this experiment, which I invite you to try for yourself. which is on my website, sheldrake.org. This is an online staring experiment using the camera on your computer, you know, like in a Skype call. And the test, you have a friend or you can have multiple people looking at you elsewhere. And in some trials, you're looked at. In other trials, you're not looked at. And after each trial, you have to guess if you're being looked at or not. Can people tell through the internet when people are paying attention to them, when they're looking at them? Well, I wish I could tell you the result. I only launched this experiment about 3 weeks ago, and we haven't got enough data. The data are positive, but I haven't got enough to do a statistical analysis yet. So I want more people to do it, and I hope some of you will help out. Now, you see, there are many implications of this. What about television? If it works through closed-circuit television, would it work through live television? If it works with one person looking at you, what would it do? What would it happen if there's a million people looking at you? This is a feasible experiment. I've tried to persuade television companies to do it. No one yet has, partly because nowadays they have most of their programs are recorded rather than live. This would obviously have to be done live. My suggested design is to have 4 or 5 celebrities who are used to being on TV, have them all in separate rooms with cameras running, and then show one of the 5 at random to the millions of viewers, and the other 4 wouldn't be seen by anybody. You measure their skin resistance and also ask them to guess, are you being looked at now? The whole experiment wouldn't take more than about 5 minutes. It would be of enormous interest to TV viewers. And if it turned out that people are affected by being seen on TV, it would help us understand a bit more about what happens to celebrities and people in the public eye. It's not just sending out images, something may be coming back that influences them. As I say, the experiment hasn't been done. It wouldn't be expensive, it wouldn't be difficult, but there's a tremendous resistance to doing this because it's anomalous. And it doesn't fit into this standard worldview. So if any of you work for TV and know someone who might be able to arrange this experiment, please let me know and let Chris know too, and we could sit there in the studio afterwards discussing the results. Anyway, I don't think this is a peculiarly human thing at all. I think it's animals as well. All animals with image-forming eyes would be projecting out images into the world around them. We wouldn't see these projections any more than we see the projections from your mobile phone. This room, if you'd got them switched on, would be full of mobile phone waves, radiations, but you wouldn't see any of them. I think all animals are projecting out visual fields through their eyes. And if so, this should be testable. Can animals tell when they're being looked at? And can animals tell when other animals are looking at them? Well, there have been no empirical studies, no investigations at all in the literature with animals. So I asked hunters who have a lot of experience, deer stalking hunters, who creep up to try and shoot deer, and they obviously try not to make a noise, and they try not to be upwind so the deer can smell them and so forth. This is just part of their standard. It wouldn't work unless they were very, very careful about ruling out sensory cues. And many of these people who hunt say that when you've got a deer in the sights of your rifle, you have to shoot very fast, because if you don't, the deer will get nervous and run off. It'll somehow sense you're there. I also interviewed a whole lot of wildlife photographers, the winning ones from the Natural History Museum Wildlife Photography of the Year contest a few years ago, and asked them if they'd found when they were watching wildlife whether they thought the animals or birds could feel them, even if they were in a hide, shooting the film from a distance with a telephoto lens. Most of them said yes. They said, if you get the animal in your sights, take the photo quickly, because they somehow know when you're watching them, even if they can't see you, even if you're a long way off, even if you're in a dark hide. So The people who are most experienced in this seem to think it happens. I should have said earlier that in the human realm too, I've interviewed the people who are experts on this, watching others. Most of us are amateurs, but there are people who do it for a living. I'm thinking of people like the store detectives in London department stores, security staff, the drug squad at Heathrow, surveillance officers and private detectives. I and my assistants interviewed dozens of people in the security business, and almost all of them say, yes, of course, if you're watching someone, they'll feel it if you're staring at them. If you're trained as a private detective, the first thing you learn is that when you're following someone, don't stare at their back, because they're likely to turn around, catch your eye, and your cover's blown. You have to watch them a bit, or else you lose them. So you stare at their feet. You look at their feet as little as you need to. In the martial arts, this is taken for granted. And many martial arts courses involve training programs to increase sensitivity. People are blindfolded, and they have to detect where an attack is being directed towards them from, behind them. And obviously it's very useful to be able to feel that, because your life might be saved in a really threatening condition. In the British SAS, when soldiers are being taught how to stab people in the back, they're trained not to stare at the person's back as they creep up behind them, or they're likely to feel them coming, turn around and shoot them. So these things are common knowledge among people who spend a lot of time watching others. Even closed-circuit television personnel are very aware of this phenomenon. Again, I interviewed people who watch others through CCTV, and for a while I got very interested in the whole inside world of security and surveillance. I even subscribed for a while to the key magazines in the area, which most of you have probably never read, CCTV Today and, and Surveillance Weekly. When I spoke to them, most of them said, yes, of course, we've noticed this lots of times. They don't have a problem with it. They don't say, no, very few of them were reflective. Very few of them said, well, this ought not to happen if these theories are right and so on. It was just, of course, this is what happens. It's just based on experience. Some people think that their pet animals can influence them by staring at them. Some people think their dog or cat can wake them in the morning by staring at them plaintively, even though it's not making a noise. Now, of course, they're not awake, so to observe how much noise is going on, but this could easily be done using surveillance cameras in the bedroom. I haven't got any volunteers for this experiment yet. It could also be done with domestic pets. Can you wake up your sleeping dog or cat by staring at it? The slogan for this research is, don't let sleeping dogs lie. Stare at them and see if you can wake them up. Many parents have found that if they stare at their babies, the babies are likely to wake up. So having got the baby to sleep, the last thing they want to do is go and stare at it, because then it wakes up again. So there's a huge amount of personal experience, anecdotal experience, a huge amount on this. And I think it's real. It's still a taboo topic, but I think it's time to let go of that taboo and open up this discussion, which would then integrate people's actual experience and open up the possibility of a whole new realm of research in natural history. Because I think if this phenomenon's real, it probably plays a major role in predator-prey relationships. A prey animal that could tell when a hidden predator was watching it would have a better chance of escaping than one that couldn't tell. So there'd be a natural selection for this sensitivity. I'm not suggesting at all that this is paranormal. I'm saying it's normal. I'm not suggesting it's supernatural. I think it's totally natural, totally normal, part of our biological nature. We have it not because we're special, but because we're animals. And many animal species have it too. It's possible to devise experiments with animals to test this. And I, in fact, devised one and tried carrying it out with our cat. the cat and mouse scenario is a perfect one for this, you see, because if mice can tell when cats are looking at them, they'd escape better than if they can't. So I had a one-way mirror, a cardboard shield, a cat, and on the other side a cage. Unfortunately, I wasn't being able to do it with wild mice. I started catching them. Then I had a terrible problem with my wife, who objected to me bringing wild mice into the house or encouraging domestic mice. I had to do it with a gerbil that one of my sons was looking after for a friend. And the gerbil... we filmed the gerbil. We had periods when the screen was removed. The cat was staring at it intently. And then other periods when it wasn't being looked at. Did it behave differently? No. I then thought, well, you haven't done the control experiment. What happens without the screen? And put the cage down on the floor. The cat went up to it like this, its nose pressed, and the gerbil just came up to it and sniffed its nose. And what I hadn't known was that this gerbil lived with a cat and a dog and was not at all afraid of them. Anyway, with the suitable conditions, a wild mouse and a cat, readily available living organisms, no problem with ethics committees, very simple experiment. It would be a great MSc project or an undergraduate project. No one's yet done it. So if any of you are looking for projects, try the cat and mouse experiment. The implications for understanding huge swathes of natural history would be huge. So I think our minds are extended beyond our brains through every act of attention. And in fact, the Latin word attention means to stretch out. Tendere, the Latin word, means to stretch out, as in tent, tension, etc. Ad means towards. Attention means stretching towards. It's about stretching our minds towards something. I think the word itself tells us about the extended mind. And of course, extended also means stretched out. So the other way in which attention stretches out is through intention, which means to stretch into. And I think that when we have intentions directed towards a person or an animal, that intention can also be felt by the person. And I think that's one of the bases for telepathy. Again, I don't think telepathy is paranormal. I think it's normal. I don't think it's anomalistic. I think it's normal. I don't think it's supernatural, I think it's natural, and I think it's an animal ability that many animals have much better developed than humans. I think it's grounded in the way in which social animals have to relate to each other. All social animals automatically have to be part of a group and coordinate their movements and interrelations with each other. This is a diagram showing how, in a holistic way of thinking about nature, nature's evolved involves different levels. The small circles could be subatomic particles, the next level up atoms, next level molecules, the next level crystals, or organelles, cells, tissues, organs, and then organisms, and then societies of organisms. I think all of these levels of organization, where the whole is more than the sum of the parts, are organized by what I call morphic fields, which are fields to do with shape or form that coordinate wholeness that's more than the sum of the parts. That's a theory I've talked about here before, and I don't have time to go into it this evening. I'll just have to say, I think there are these fields for social groups. And when we look at flocks of starlings, here are some more flocks of starlings, we see extraordinarily well-coordinated movements, where the whole thing behaves almost like a single organism. There have been many attempts to try and explain this. And the simplest ones are to say, well, they just have a simple algorithm. They measure how fast and how near the bird's nearest neighbors are, and then they respond to those, and it's just kind of a computer algorithm that generates this. That was a theory in the 1980s. The best known model of that kind is called Boyd's by Craig Reynolds. But it's actually much more complicated than that, because these birds respond too quickly to explain it just in terms of watching the neighbours and then reacting. There's a minimum reaction time that any animal has to a stimulus, and this is happening too quickly. So one theory is they respond to the entire field, or at least the area around them, a kind of gestalt or pattern, which could be part of a morphic field theory. Some people think, well, they're measuring where the others are through patterns in the light that comes through the flock. There's a big discussion on this. There are a lot of sophisticated computer models now. The most sophisticated ones are field models based on incorporating combined equations from flow patterns, which are a kind of field model, and magnetic fields. But it's not enough for the birds to know where their neighbours are. They have to know where they're going to go and anticipate their movements. Otherwise, they'd bump into them. So I think there's a field of the whole flock. I think all animal groups have fields. The same goes for schools of fish. And the same general arguments apply to modelling how this could happen. Well, I think that members of animal groups are linked together through these fields, that when an animal group splits up, when some members go somewhere else, they remain bonded with the others. For example, when wolves go hunting, they leave the young, the cubs, in the den, usually with a babysitter, and they go hunting, ranging over large distances to bring food to feed the young. I'm suggesting that when they're apart, the links between them, the bond, the field that links the different members of the social group, doesn't break, it's stretched, and as this stretched field works like a kind of invisible elastic band, connecting them to each other at a distance. That, I think, is the medium through which telepathic influences can pass. There's already evidence from naturalists studying wolves in the wild that they seem to pick up what other members of the group are doing at a great distance, far beyond the range of smell, hearing, etc. And when I got interested in this, I thought, well, what about looking at domestic pets? Because they're the animals we know best. They form strong bonds with us. And I started by appealing to people to say, have you ever noticed that your cat or dog picks up your thoughts or intentions? I have now a database of more than 5,000 case studies of this, where people have told me about their experiences with their pets. For example, hundreds of people have told me that their cat seems to pick up their intention to take it to the vet and disappears. And it's very annoying for people when they can't find their cat. And when it's happened a few times, they try desperately not to give the cat any clues. They don't get out the carrying basket. They think, how does the cat know? Must have seen the carrying basket. So they don't get it out. Still disappears. And then they think, must have heard me talking about the vet. So they don't talk about the vet. And they say, maybe it feels me thinking about the vet. I mustn't think about the vet. I mustn't think about the vet. The cat still knows. And some of them even ring up from work to make an appointment with the vet so the cat can't overhear the conversation. And yet they still seem to know. So we got interested in this. You know, are these just a few scattered anecdotes? How common is it? We rang up all the veterinary clinics in North London, 65 of them. And we asked them, had you ever had problems with people missing appointments with their cat? 64 out of 65 said, yes, it happens all the time. The remaining one said, it happens so often we've given up the appointment system for cats. People just have to arrive with their animal. So that's an area you could do experiments with that. But the one where it's easiest to do experiments is with dogs and cats that know when their owners are coming home. And as some of you know, this is an area I've investigated in some detail. Many people, over 1,000 people, have given me stories of how their dog knows when they're coming home, even if they come at unusual times, and often, in many cases, 10 minutes, 15 minutes, half an hour in advance. No one would be surprised if it's a routine time and it's only a minute or two in advance when the dog could have heard the crunch of car wheels on the gravel or footsteps in the street. But these happen much before, even when people are travelling by unfamiliar vehicles or public transport. Well, again, when I talk to some of my sceptical friends, in particular Nicholas Humphrey, who's a very old friend of mine and who's a very hardcore sceptic, to my surprise, when I told him I was interested in this, he didn't deny the phenomenon. He said, oh, my dog used to do that. My mother always knew when I was coming home. And I said, well, how do you think it did it? He said, well, they've got really sharp hearing. It must have heard my car. And I said, how long in advance? He said, oh, about half an hour. I said, you must have been 20 miles away, the other side of the M11, when this happened. We're irrespective of the wind direction, how do you think you're... He said, oh, it just shows what sharp hearing they've got. So that's what gave me the idea for an experiment. I said, well, what would happen if you took the train, borrowed a bicycle and cycled from the station so there's no familiar car sounds? Would the dog know when you were coming or wouldn't it? And he said, no, of course not. And I said, well, why don't we try it? He said, well, unfortunately, it's just died. So, anyway, basically, that's the kind of experiment I've done. We have people whose dogs do it fairly reliably, go at least 5 miles from home. They come home at randomly chosen times. They do it. We film the place the dog waits the whole time they're out. And they travel in unfamiliar vehicles, like taxis. And in these experiments, oh, first of all, let me show you the results of random household surveys. In Britain and in California, we did random household surveys to find out how many dog and cat owners had noticed this behavior. It's about 50% of dogs anticipate the arrival of their owners, and about 30% of cats on average. For some reason, they're all better at it in Los Angeles. It doesn't prove cats are less sensitive. Some of them, including our own, lamentably, are just less interested. I mean, my own cats have been a terrible disappointment to me from this point of view. It's a common phenomenon. Again, like the sense of being stared at, this is one of what I call one of the mysteries of everyday life. These are things almost everybody knows about. Either they've seen it themselves, they've got friends or family members who've seen it. These are common phenomena. I found that in this case there have been no scientific investigations whatever, because it doesn't fit on the map. Using the kind of experiments I described, we did some experiments with a dog called JT. At the top is some long absences. The horizontal axis are 10-minute periods after the owner went out. The vertical axis is the number of seconds the dog spent waiting at the window or at the window within a 10-minute period. As you see, the very last circle is the first 10 minutes of the homeward journey. We cut off homeward journey after that. Usually they were 20-minute journeys because we wanted to eliminate any possibility of hearing car sounds, even though in many cases they were unfamiliar cars. You'll see that the dogs did go to the windows occasionally, for a bit of the time, when the owner was not coming home. And when you look at the films, in most cases you can see a reason for this. A cat goes past, they go and bark. Or someone draws up outside and unloads a car and they go to watch. But the amount of time they spend waiting at the window is greatest in the return period and in the period immediately before that. Of course, in the period before the return, the person is thinking about going home. The return period begins when the car engine is switched off and switched on and starts moving. So what seems to be happening is the dog's picking up the person's intention to come home. Now, I have films of this. They've been shown on TV, and when this first came out, it was challenged by skeptics, of course. I invited Richard Wiseman to do some experiments with this same dog, did 3 experiments in the same location, and the results of his experiments taken from his paper, plotted in the same way as my own, a method that was suggested by him, Wiseman himself, are here. They show exactly the same pattern. And it was statistically significant, even with just these 3 trials. Richard Wiseman went on television saying the dog had failed the test because it had gone to the window before the person set off home. And when I said, well, look at the whole of the data, look at the graph of your whole data, he said, oh, I can't look at that. That's a retrospective analysis. It doesn't count. And so we had a long argument in the scientific literature about the interpretation of these data. But most people who've looked at them, even Wiseman himself now, think that his data show the same pattern as my own. This is just one of the ways in which you can investigate what seems to be a telepathic link between people and dogs. It works with cats as well, and parrots, and a number of other organisms. All the cases I've got are with mammals or birds. I haven't got any cases of return anticipating reptiles, even though I tried to find out quite hard. I mean, I spoke to a whole lot of snake and lizard owners, and I put out appeals for information in Reptilian International, the leading magazine for serious reptile keepers. I haven't yet come across any return anticipating goldfish. Animals that form strong bonds with their owners quite often show this behaviour. The commonest, of course, are dogs and cats because they're the commonest animals that people keep. Parrots are very good at it too, and some parrots even announce the owner by shouting their name 5 or 10 minutes before they get home. Now, telepathy in humans, I think, follows similar principles. Unfortunately, most research by parapsychologists has started not from real-life situations, but from totally artificial situations created in the laboratory, like the Ganzfeld experiment, where the subject lies with white noise through earphones, half ping-pong balls over their eyes, white noise, while a total stranger in another room looks at a randomly selected video. Well, telepathy doesn't typically work with strangers. It's amazing they get positive results. They do, but they're not very impressive. I try and start from what people have noticed. And one area that I've been doing research is with mothers and babies. Many mothers have told me that they have found that their baby seems to know, they seem to know when their baby needs them. When they go back to work, if they're still breastfeeding, many mothers have found that they might be just sitting at a desk or shopping on the way home when their breasts tingle, start squeezing out milk. This is called the milk letdown reflex. It's mediated by oxytocin, the hormone, and it normally happens when the mother hears the baby cry. When mothers experience this away from the baby, they just assume that this is because the baby needs them. They used to go home, now they ring home on their mobile phone. And I did a study with 19 nursing mothers in North London, which showed that they were right way beyond chance. It was odds of 1 billion to 1. I described this in my book, The Sense of Being Stared At and Other Aspects of the Extended Mind. But the commonest kind, by far, in the modern world of telepathy happens with phone calls, telephone telepathy. Most people, surveys show about 80% of the population have had the experience of thinking of someone for no apparent reason. Then that person rings, and they say, that's funny, I was just thinking about you. Or else they just know who it is when the phone rings before they look at the caller ID or answer the phone. Extremely common. I bet most people in this room have had that experience. Surveys that we've done in a variety of countries have shown that among women, about 95% claim to have had this experience, about 72% of men. There were very few national differences between women. They were way up there everywhere we did it. But with the men, there were national differences. The Argentinian men were the most sensitive, and guess what? The British men were the least sensitive. A lot of people claim this happens. Now, those of you who are studying anomalistic psychology will immediately realize the fact they claim it doesn't prove it's real. They could be just deceiving themselves, or their mind could be playing tricks. And the commonest skeptical explanation, which has been ruling the roost since telephones were invented at the beginning of the 20th century, you've all heard, and probably some of you will have said, oh, well, when this happens, how do you know it's really telepathy? It's probably just coincidence. You think of people all the time. If you're thinking of them, they ring, then you think it must be telepathy. You just forget the millions of times you're wrong. Selective memory and coincidence. Good hypothesis. But in science, it's not enough to have a hypothesis. You need evidence for your hypothesis. And when I got interested in this, I found, when I talked to my skeptic friends, I said, OK, where's the literature on how often people think of others? Not one single study on this phenomenon, because it's a taboo. So I've devised a simple experiment. The basic experiment involves people who say this happens to them quite often have four callers. We pick the caller at random. These are people they know well. We ring up the person who's the caller and ask them to phone their friend who's on a landline. They're being filmed. in many of the experiments. Before they answer the phone, they have to guess who it is. I think it's John. Hello, John. They're right or they're wrong. By chance, by coincidence, they'd be right one time in four, 25%. Well, in these experiments, the chance rate of 25% is in blue. The actual hit rate, these are unfilmed tests, our preliminary test was 40%. The p-value is 4 times 10 to the minus 16. And these are massively significant figures. I'm always meeting people who say, oh, there's not a shred of evidence for telepathy. All the experiments have failed. It's just not true. There's very good evidence for it. This is one of the studies that shows it. We then did it with filmed experiments. The hit rate was higher because we picked the most talented subjects for this these film tests, where they couldn't have been cheating. And we then compared familiar and unfamiliar callers, because the hypothesis is telepathy works between bonded members of social groups, not with strangers. And with the two stranger callers, the hit rate was practically at the chance level, and with the familiar callers was more than twice the chance level. So these experiments have now been done, they've been replicated at the universities of Amsterdam and Freiburg. There's a higher hit rate with familiar callers. There's no effect of distance. We've done them with people we recruited in London among young Australians and New Zealanders. We tested them with two callers who are new acquaintances in Britain, and the other two, their nearest and dearest down under. And they did better, well above chance, with the nearest and dearest on the other side of the world, showing that what matters is emotional closeness rather than physical proximity. It's a great way of doing distance effects in telepathy. There are no distance effects as far as we can see. Sometimes people say that proves it's not real because all physical phenomena fall off at distance. But that's not true. Quantum non-locality, which is the closest physical analogy to this, where quantum particles have been part of the same system, when they move apart, remain entangled or non-locally connected at a distance. That doesn't fall off with distance. It can be over many miles, and a change in one instantly affects the other. So it's also possible to do these tests with automated experiments on the internet. I have one at the moment running on my website, which you can do on mobile phones. I've done some earlier experiments, which are all published in journals. You can find them on my website. Chris and I started a joint experiment that wasn't completed here at Goldsmiths on telephone telepathy. And I have to say, I don't think you'll mind me mentioning that the only person in any of these tests who scored zero is Chris himself. with a sample of one, you can't say it's statistically significantly below the chance level, but well below the chance level. And as I said to Chris, you know, this is something more's going on here than just random guessing. And Chris, who, as you know, has a great sense of humour, said to me, well, my friends are always telling me I'm a psychic in denial. This is an area of research that is still going on. You can take part in it yourself. I have got a film of one of these experiments, but I've already run over time. It's 5 minutes. What do you think, Chris? Should I show it? Okay. I'll show you. This film is of an experiment done for television with the Nolan sisters. A TV company approached me and said they wanted to do an experiment of this kind. And I said, you could work with the people I'm working with. They said, oh, no, they won't do. This is television. We need celebrities. So I said, well, okay, but they've got to know each other well. And they came up with the Nolan sisters. So here's a test with the Nolan sisters.
If you look at the modern world, despite all discouragement, most people believe that they've had telepathic experiences. And interestingly, the most common kind of telepathy in the modern world is precisely one that's grown up alongside technologies. In other words, telepathy connected with telephone calls.
So many people tell stories of telephone telepathy that Dr. Sheldrake devised a test to see whether someone could predict who, out of four people, was calling them. The probability of being correct by guesswork alone was 25%.
We've now completed 1,000 of these trials, and the average success rate is 42%, which is hugely significant statistically. People certainly aren't right every time, but it's way above what you'd expect by chance.
So, is telephone telepathy real, or is it just a figment of the imagination? We brought one of the most successful girl bands of the 80s to London to find out. The Nolan sisters are one of the closest families in showbiz. At the height of their fame, they spent months on the road together, and most of them still live within miles of each other.
I'm Rupert Sheldrake.
But how well will they do in the telephone telepathy test?
Now, could you tell me all your names in order, please?
Yes, I'm Denise Nolan. I'm the most intelligent one here.
I'm Maureen.
She's just Maureen. Hi, I'm Linda, and Denise is a liar.
I'm Colleen.
Colleen is the youngest, and I'm Anne. I'm the eldest.
Why do you say that?
Because I want people to say I look good for my age.
Maybe you don't.
Not really.
The first stage of the experiment is to decide which of the sisters will be the receiver.
So four of you are going to stay here. One of you is going to go to the hotel and try and guess which of the others is phoning. So we've got to pick the person to do that.
It's got to be Colleen.
Colleen is nominated by her sisters because she's the youngest. And while she's driven a mile away to the other location, Dr. Sheldrake allocates each of the other sisters a number between 1 and 4. For each trial, a throw of the dice will determine who will be the caller.
So we're going to start now with the first one. I'm going to throw the die. 2.
Yes.
There you are, Maureen. So you've only got 2 minutes.
Maureen's first up, and the rest of the group must leave the room to allow her to focus.
Let me think about her.
When the phone rings, Colleen will have to say who she thinks is calling before she picks up.
Right. Maureen. Maureen.
Yes! Oh, yes! Yes! Thank God for that. Thank you. Lovely talking to you.
Bye.
Bye.
I knew she'd get it.
Yes! Bloody hell.
Sorry.
But that could just be coincidence. Next up is Anne, the only sceptic among the sisters.
Denise.
No, you're wrong.
With 4 sisters to choose from, if it's purely guesswork, Colleen should expect to be right 25% of the time by the end of the experiment.
Think of your favourite sister. The most talented one.
I'm not getting anything now. I don't want to be wrong.
Linda.
Linda.
Yes!
Yes!
Yes! Yes!
Good girl.
You're not fake.
Oh, thank you.
Oh, bye.
Thanks
bye.
For calling. Bye.
Bye.
Yes!
That's good, isn't it?
Halfway through, and Colleen is a long way ahead of the 25% expected by chance alone. Anne's number has come up 4 times, but for the previous 3, Colleen has guessed wrong.
Anne.
Yes! Hooray! I knew you loved me, really.
3/4 of the way through, and Colleen's hit rate has reached over 40%. According to Dr. Sheldrake, this indicates there's more going on than simple guesswork.
Maureen or Linda, I think. Linda. Linda.
Yes!
Yes! Yes!
Oh, my God!
I'm so impressed.
I'm scaring them now. They're backing out the room.
They should never have gone in there with you, love.
Fantastic. Thank you. Bye.
Wow.
Colleen's final score is 50%, one of the highest of over 1,000 tests conducted by Dr. Sheldrake.
Anyway, well done. I think that was great.
Thank you.
Thanks very much.
I enjoyed it.
Well done, that girl. Oh,
cheers!
Don't block my face.
Good. Well, it was fun working with the Nolan sisters, as you saw. Well, in conclusion, I'd just like to say what I'm talking about, the extended mind, makes sense of our own direct experience. You're experiencing images outside your head, not inside it. And I think that's where they really are. You don't have to contort yourself and reinterpret all your own most immediate experience in the name of a theory, which is, I think, an outmoded 19th century theory of matter. Field theories allow physical processes to extend in space. That's what fields are all about. So you don't have to cling on to that theory out of some loyalty to physicalism or materialism. You can expand the vision of matter that materialism is based on. Secondly, by admitting the extended mind, then a lot of these so-called mysteries of everyday life that I've been talking about make sense. Instead of being anomalies that can't be investigated except with scare quotes in a few tiny pockets of the academic world and tabooed and exiled from rational discourse, they can be incorporated. There's nothing scary about them. They can be understood more fully. We'll learn a lot more about animal minds and about our own, and they'll enable us to interpret a lot of natural history. And thirdly, it means you can take seriously your own experiences. These experiences, the sense of being stared at, dogs that knowing when their own, knowing when their owners are coming home, and telephone telepathy, are something that you or many of your friends will have personally experienced. And there's no need to deny them. There's no need to pretend they don't exist, because I think they do. I mean, there could be more scientific evidence. I hope there will be. I hope there'll be many more research projects based on this, and some indeed are starting. But I think that this is, I should say finally, this is independent of your religious or non-religious views, because the psychic phenomena, I think, are part of the way minds work in nature. They're part of nature. They're totally natural. It's a completely separate question whether there's a consciousness beyond nature, whether God exists or any other form of superhuman consciousness. There are a lot of people who are practicing Christians who don't like psychic phenomena and who are skeptical about them. There are a lot of people who are atheists who do think they exist. I did a survey of the Parapsychological Association meeting in Paris a few years ago. Out of 24 people there, practicing parapsychologists, 12 were atheists or agnostics, and 12 were people who were either religious or spiritual, but not religious. It was about half and half. So it's an independent variable, and doesn't need to enter into this debate at all, the religious question. I think that some dogmatic skeptics feel they've got to be dogmatically denying psychic phenomena, because as soon as you allow the mind to be anything more than just the material brain, then religion will be back and the Pope will be moving in and so on. So they feel they've got to stop them. What I'm trying to say, if any of you feel slightly inclined that way, relax, it doesn't matter. These things, you can have an expanded mind and leave aside the whole religious or non-religious question. It's not particularly relevant to that. And I think enables you to take more seriously your own experience and that of people you know. Thank you.
Lots of food for thought there. There's so many things I wanted to come back on, but I'm not going to dominate the question and answer session. We'll throw it over the floor, so if you have questions.
Hi, thank you so much for your talk. I was actually really curious about your TV experiment, and I was wondering if you considered using YouTube personalities instead, who are, could be said to be celebrities online, and to measure them through live streaming of either their family members watching or their fans watching or no one at all, to see if they have that same telepathic effect.
Well, I do have... I've got my mobile telephone experiment working on mobile phones, and I've got the online staring experiment, which will also work on mobile telephones. So I am using these techniques. I mean, my own technical capacities are quite limited. I have to hire people to develop these. But there's plenty of scope for developing automated online experiments using the available technologies. I mean, some of these could be mounted in Facebook platforms where you could find people who are willing to do an experiment right now. There's a lot of potential for that. What I've done so far is I've only scratched the surface of what could be done. One of the reasons it hasn't been done is that it's difficult to make money out of these things. You know, there are people who've considered making apps. I gave a talk on this at Google, at their research center. Some people at Google were very, very interested. But basically, you know, there was no money in it, and it's a business. So, but for research purposes, I think there's a huge potential.
What might be the nature of these fields? Is there any evidence or thoughts on what?
What are they? It's hard to say. I think in my book, The Presence of the Past, where I discuss this whole hypothesis in most detail, I suggest that they're fields of probability that work by modifying otherwise random events. I mean, at every level of organization, everything's always on the edge of randomness. Everyone knows about quantum level and about the climate and chaos theory. But, you know, our nerve cells in the brain, the whole brain, there are lots of things that are hovering on the edge, could go one way or the other. And I think these things impose patterns on otherwise random changes. Now, exactly how they work, I don't know. But as soon as you ask the question, what exactly is the nature of a field, when you get to the gravitational field, then no one knows. I mean, people are trying to explain in terms of superstring theory, 10-dimensional superfields, electromagnetic fields, what exactly is their nature? In the 19th century, people thought they were made of ether. Then Einstein said, no, they're not. They're just free-floating fields. What are they made of? They're just made of fields. So quantum matter fields, what's an electron field made of? It's just a field. There's no subtle matter that it's made of. There are many kinds of fields in physics, none of which have any ontological status other than being fields, with the hope that they might eventually be explained in terms of some superfield, as in 10-dimensional string theory. Basically, it's fields all the way down. I dare say the same would apply if there's more theoretical attention given to what I call morphic fields. So it's not a very satisfactory answer, but it's not very satisfactory in relation to any fields.
Just listening to your response to that question, I interpret that as fields of potential future trajectories. And so what you do will suck events towards a particular direction.
That's a very good way of putting it, yes. Well done. I mean, that's a really good, clear play. I wish I'd thought of it myself. I think most models, there are mathematical models of morphic fields. Part of them are based on the work of René Thom, the French mathematician. And almost all the models that exist, some are by my friend Ralph Abraham, are in terms of dynamics. And dynamics is a branch of mathematics that models things in terms of where they're going. They're moving towards attractors. An attractor in a dynamical field is something that, as it were, sucking things towards it. And I think morphic fields in general have that character. They're dynamical fields. When I say dynamical, I mean you can make dynamical field models of them. And those are the best kinds of models. They make the most sense of what they're doing, based on attractors. Of course, you could then ask, what are attractors in dynamical fields? But if you do ask that, that would apply to almost all of physics, where dynamical attractors are invoked, and no one really knows. They're just a way of describing the way nature works.
experiments, how much can you distinguish between what you're talking about, possible projection of visual images or vision and potential, so effects of the images or potential?
It's a very good question. How can you distinguish between the projection of visual images and just paying attention? Well, one way of doing it would be to ask people not to look at another person, but just to think about them, or possibly to focus their attention on a photograph of that person. And I've done a few experiments of that kind, and I think that the ones with the photographs did show some effect. And so I think that just paying attention, because it works on CCTV, this suggests that the attention model might be a better one than the visual field itself. My own guess is that actual visual attention, direct visual attention, is probably more powerful than just thinking about someone or looking at their photo. CCTV results show a much weaker effect than direct staring effects, and there you're looking at an image. Of course, mirrors provide another way, because when you're looking at someone through a mirror, you do get these effects, staring through mirrors. And what you're staring at in the mirror is not directly at the person, but at the virtual image of the person behind the mirror. So there's another way of looking at it. So I think it's attention is definitely one of the key things in this. But visual attention through direct looking is probably the more powerful way. And there are other forms of attention, like indirect, you know, mirror images, CCTV images, photographs, or just thinking about somebody.
Do you think that children in schools should be exposed to some of these ideas or experimental evidence? I mean, that could make it more accessible in the future generations.
Well, this gets into the politics of education. I mean, I do think that. And when I give talks in schools about this work, the children are really interested. I was, in fact, asked to give a talk to the annual meeting of the heads of science in the Eton Group of Independent Schools. And these are not wildly radical figures. Heads of science in our most expensive fee-paying schools are not tearaway radicals or mavericks. And the reason they wanted me to give the talk is that when I've given talks in schools, both primary and secondary schools, there's a buzz of interest for days afterwards. And science teachers have a terrible job making students interested in science, because what it comes across to them as is just a whole lot of facts you've got to learn for exams. It's no excitement of discovery. I mean, if any child discovers something that's not in the textbook, no one's going to be in the slightest interested. So there's learning facts for exams. And then I come along and say, look, here's all these experiments. You can actually do them yourselves. And sometimes I've done these in schools with groups of children. They get really excited. The idea they can be on the cutting edge of science, dealing with things that affect their everyday experience. It's a really engaging way of teaching science. But the political issue comes in that psychic phenomena are classified as anomalistic or borderline or fringe, or if you read Wikipedia, you'll see that they don't exist. There's no evidence for them. So there's a thing that they're denied. There's a great deal of culture of denial, and it's a dangerous thing. Any school teacher who did it would probably get into serious, severe trouble. That's the problem. The children have no problem with it at all. They find it really interesting. And in independent schools, where they have a bit more time and less, they feel less of the pressure of the national curriculum, some teachers enjoy bringing these subjects in to discussions in classes precisely because it engages the students. There's always some skeptics there who say, no, it's impossible. And then the argument becomes, well, what would evidence look like? How would you decide the issue? Is it a matter of faith, belief, or is it a matter of evidence? And really interesting discussions take place. So I only wish it happened much more than it does, but and it could do, and I dare say in the future it will do.
Are these fields anything to do with the phenomena of being able to predict the future, where it's not necessarily related to another person's mind, but you can already visualise the scenery?
Are these fields related to what we could call precognition, maybe, or presentiment? I don't know. Some people have precognitive dreams. In fact, most of us probably have them, but we forget them. If you make the practice of writing your dreams down, most people who do that find that they're actually having precognitive dreams quite often, dreaming about things that happen in the next few days. I've done that myself, and I was pretty sure it was real. I convinced myself by doing the experiment myself. I wouldn't necessarily have believed anyone else, but I think these things happen. But I don't know how they're related to the telepathic links which are happening in the present, or the sense of being stared at. Those are things that are happening right now. Anything that involves influences from the future is harder to understand in our present framework. The closest, the things that where you get the most repeatable effects with influences from the future are very short-term ones, so-called presentiment, where people who have a stimulus that makes them emotionally aroused start being emotionally aroused up to 5 seconds beforehand in a measurable way. I mean, that's a whole other range of experiments I don't have time to talk about. Not my own research. But I would say nobody really knows, and there's a lot of discussion about whether quantum physics would allow backwards causation and so on. And then there's whole amounts of science fiction about backwards causation and logical loops and so on. I mean, it's a vast topic, so sorry I can't go much further now.
You've spoken a lot about vision. I'm wondering, how does it apply to other senses? So, for example, I mean, could a dog tell when it was being smelled?
Well, that's a good question. I've never actually even thought of doing experiments with smell. I have done them with hearing. Can you tell when you're being listened to? I designed an experiment that works on the telephone. I mean, I know for a start from common observation that you know, some people can't tell if they're being listened to. They drone on and on. But in my Can You Tell If You're Being Listened To experiments, which work on mobile phones, I haven't got them online at the moment, but I designed an experiment where I would be talking, if I were doing it with you, I would be talking, it would say, this trial begins, I would then talk to you for, say, 20 seconds, and at random, you would either hear me, or you'd hear some music instead on your mobile phone. And after 20 seconds, I would have to press a button that said, were you being listened to during this trial? Press 1 for yes, press 2 for no. I've done this experiment, and the results are pretty close to chance. I was expecting you might get a positive effect, similar to the staring and the phone call. But it may be that some people are more sensitive than others, but it wasn't very encouraging. And I think that the results were suggest that people perhaps, at least in that setup, can't. Tell very easily, partly because it's so artificial. When you're talking, you don't know if someone's listening to you or not. You don't talk normally, and you get on edge. There may be a better experimental design. But anyway, it's a doable experiment, and I've done it in one format, and I think a better format could be worked out. I also did try... I went to the spy shop in London... where they sell listening devices. And there's one in, just off Bond Street. And I said to them, have you ever had people...
Appropriately enough.
Yes. I said, have you ever had people saying that they can tell when they're being listened to on your devices? They looked a bit blank and said no. So I went next door. There's a shop next door called the Anti-Spy Shop. I asked them the same, and a similarly negative response. So unlike with surveillance, visual surveillance, there wasn't an instant, say, oh, yes, this happened the other day. And you know, there wasn't lots of anecdotes suddenly unleashed by these questions. So I just don't know. That's the answer.
Well, it's quite a good question. Are you
Am I telepathic? Well, I'm sometimes. I'm not. I don't claim to be above average. I'm probably a bit below average. But I score above chance in my own telephone telepathy tests. I've had quite a lot of anecdotal telepathic experiences, but I don't hold myself up as being particularly good at this. On the whole, the people who are best at this are children and people. The more educated that you are, and the more male you are, the less likely you are to be good at these things. And I fall into the kind of lowest scoring category, white, male, educated. But even I can do. Chris, when he gets out of his denial phase, if he can get naught in a test where you should be getting three or four by chance, he could be a psychic superstar.
Lady in the back there, and then.
So, have you ever decided to do any studies with a neurologist to look at how, when people experience telepathy, to see what's going on in their brain, like physically, to see what kind of blood flow that it is conditioned to?
Well, I haven't done experiments with brain scans or EEGs. Partly because those are expensive, and I have to do my research on very, very low budgets because, it's hard to get grants for this kind of thing. One of the problems with that is that telepathy is not terribly reliable. I mean, even the people who score quite well in these telephone telepathy tests, 50% instead of 25%, they're still wrong half the time. It's not as if you can get a sort of definite response that works every time. That's the first point. The second thing is that lying in an fMRI machine or something is terribly off-putting. I mean, they make this awfully loud noise, and most people can't behave very normally when they're in them. There have been physiological experiments on telepathy, which involve having people with EEGs on their brains in separate rooms, often at great distances from each other. These are people who know each other well, for example, twins. And one of them is shown a bright flash of light, which causes a kind of spike in brain activity. And the other one, in some of these experiments, significantly correlated, has a spike in brain activity correlating with the stimulus to one. So the people have been doing experiments on unconscious telepathy using physiological monitoring. So there is some literature on that, not very much. As I say, if one finds people who are very talented telepathically, who can do it quite reliably, then it would be feasible. As I say, dogs are better at this than people. But the trouble is most dog owners wouldn't want their dog to be encased in an fMRI machine or immobilized and wired up when they were on the way home. So it's partly a question of how do you persuade people to do it. Either people or dogs.